The night he died, he asked me to rub his back, and he rolled on his side, and my fingers caught in his ribs. There was nothing left of this man, and yet he was scheduled for a radiotherapy session that next day. Doesn't make sense to me.
These days are particularly peaceful for Miriam Dayhew and her husband.
Finish with sugar?
Thanks.
A few years ago, this idyllic country setting was home to her brother Peter. It's where he spent his final weeks.
This was actually Papa's room, but my father had died some years earlier, so when my brother needed a space fairly urgently, we had the space, so he came down to live with us.
Peter probably didn't look after himself as well as he could have. He had a sore throat in his mid-50s that progressed. He, as I said, he'd been a heavy smoker. He was diagnosed, he had throat cancer. These held the ashes of my father, and this held the ashes of my grandmother for quite a number of years. I think people are very uncomfortable with talking about death, and I think people are very uncomfortable with talking to someone about their imminent death.
It's a conversation Miriam says should happen, because in her brother's case, it didn't.
It could have been a conversation with him that was, we can treat you palliatively, but we're not going to cure you, so we're not going to try. Rather than going in guns blazing, say, let's see what we can do to fix it. Nothing's going to fix it. It was beyond fixing.
Peter underwent surgery to remove a lump in his throat. He spent 5 days in intensive care, and on the day he'd scheduled his first radiotherapy session, he died. He was 63.
This was an extraordinary, it's a very hard thing to say, it was an extraordinary waste of resources, of very scarce resources, on somebody who was going to get no benefit from them at all.
It's much easier to treat people than not. I mean, much easier. And the reasons for that are a couple of reasons. One is we have the technology and we feel obliged to use it. But another reason is that it actually takes a lot of time to have the kinds of conversations that you would have to have to not treat.
Dr. Peter Saul says thousands of futile medical operations are performed every year in Australia.
We often ask ourselves whether or not there's such a thing as futile care or futile treatment. Clearly some things are futile because either you won't survive or else if you do, you wouldn't have wanted to.
The medical definition of futile care is contentious. What's not, argues Dr. Saul, is the unsustainability of dishing out treatments with no benefits and high costs.
An ICU bed also costs about four times what a palliative care bed costs. If it's possible to die in palliative care, you've got the only win-win left in medicine. This is to say, you can actually do a better job at a fifth the cost. It's kind of a no-brainer.
We spend the most money on our health just before we die. Each year, around 144,000 Australians pass away. 80% are over 65. As our population ages, we face questions over where and how we spend our money and when it becomes futile.
Come on through.
It's difficult because I've got a feeling this guy won't survive, but I feel obligated to do it. Certainly the patient wants to do it.
Dr. Ben Brady prescribes the melanoma drug Yervoy to a new patient almost every week.
If I was the economist, I'd say, well, he's 83 and maybe we shouldn't be doing it. But I think if we start discriminating based on age or all of those type of things, I think we as a community get into all sorts of trouble.
You know, I've been swimming for so long that I just follow the black lines. And I find that swimming, in many ways, you can block things out of your mind. I concentrate on my stroke and what speed I'm doing and my technique, basically. When I've had a swim, I come out of that water and I feel, you know, really regenerated.
Chris Barrett is 67 and has inoperable melanoma.
I classify myself just as fit as a 40-year-old, and I wasn't afflicted with this melanoma. I can see no reason why I can't have another 20 years of decent life. I should be eligible for this treatment without anybody asking any questions. And it saddens me a little bit that people do think like that.
Chris is on his second of four doses of Yervoy.
I feel perfectly okay. It's just like someone's giving me an intravenous infusion of normal saline or something.
So when they mentioned this treatment to me, I jumped at it because I thought, well, here's a chance that I can really knock this thing on the head and get over it completely.
Yervoy has a 1 in 10 chance of ridding the body of melanoma. It also costs upwards of $100,000. In August last year, it was included on the PBS scheme. Patients now pay less than $150 for 4 treatments.
Good.
As an Australian, I've paid my taxes all my life. I've worked all my life. I don't rely on the government for any support. I don't see why I should be disadvantaged against other people when it comes to age.
The entire amount that anybody's paid into their Medicare levy wouldn't cover them for a month at the end of their life if they spent that in intensive care. The entire amount that they've paid in their whole lives. We think it takes about 2.5 hours to sit with a family and take them through some of the alternatives to intensive care. And at 2 o'clock in the morning, you get the phone call, what's easiest? I mean, I'm sorry, but that's often, sadly, the way things currently progress. And I think that has to change.
I think the best medical care is not necessarily the one with the most tools and the machines that go bing. I think the best medical care can sometimes be extraordinarily personally tailored pain relief and comfort and understanding what that person wants for their final phase of their life.
In 5 years' time, I'd hope to be still living here, still alive, still working part-time and still being active. I'm staying very positive. I think this treatment will work. That's what I think in my mind, that I'm going to beat this and this treatment's going to work.